Well, good evening, and welcome to our broadcast of the Sunday night service. I'm glad you tuned in tonight on our church Facebook page. Just a few things by way of announcement this evening. As I mentioned, we will be resuming our Wednesday night Bible study in prayer time. That'll be on Wednesday night on the 16th of September, and we are also planning on our fall class for Midwest Baptist College, and it's going to be a great class on church and Baptist history through the centuries. If you have never studied church history, this will be a great opportunity for you to take this class and learn some things that I think are very, very important. I think it's essential for all of God's people to know their history. So we're going to be starting that class a week after Labor Day, Monday night, September the 14th. Okay. Now, the message this evening I've entitled Our Mighty God of Sovereignty, and we're going to be looking at verses 6 through 9. We're going to be examining the sovereignty of God and how it's declared by past events and determined by future events, and it is demonstrated in present events. And so through it all, the psalmist shows us how God is still on his throne. The Lord is in total and complete control of everything that happens in life as well as in our own individual lives. So I trust this evening that our hearts will be challenged and blessed and encouraged from this passage of Scripture. Let's go ahead and pray and ask God's blessing on our time together this evening. Father, we thank you so much for the wonderful opportunities we have to live in this country, to have the freedoms that we do to worship you, Lord. And we continue to pray for our land, our country, those in leadership over us, Lord, that you would grant them a measure of wisdom, Lord, to make the right decisions that will affect us. And I pray to God that you'll take the message today, this evening, and use it in our lives. We thank you so much, dear God, that you are our great God, that you are sovereign, that you're the king, you're in control. And what a wonderful blessing and promise that is that we have from your word. So Lord, use this time together, this scripture that we're going to be looking at, Lord, to help us in our lives as Christians, and Lord, to help us to even more, Lord, understand and realize that we need to depend upon you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Tonight, as we continue our series on Psalm 46, which the series is entitled A Mighty Fortress is Our God, we're going to be looking at this next aspect of God's sovereignty. The other story is told of two boys who were sitting in their sandbox one day talking about God. And one boy asked, "How many gods are there?" His friend replied, "Well, there's one." And the other boy, not satisfied with that answer, asked, "Well, how do you know there's only one God?" And his friend quickly replied, "Well, I know because there's only room for one. And the Bible says that he fills heaven and earth. So thank the Lord, there is only one God and there's not room for any other." And from the very first verse of the Bible, in Genesis 1, verse 1, God made it clear that he is to be not only God, he is to be the only God. And so even though some people don't understand that, they don't acknowledge the Lord's unequaled and unparalleled position of authority, he is still the supreme one. He is still the superior one and our mighty God of sovereignty. Now you can take our world for an example. The world is made up of atoms that are so tiny, we can't see them, obviously. The atoms, these atoms add to a universe so colossal that we can't even begin to imagine its vastness. The nucleus of one atom is itself the center of a miniature universe around which whirl the electrons. The nucleus is 2,500,000,000,000ths of one inch in diameter. And then consider the sun, which is our nearest star, 93 million miles away. Its light, which travels about 6 trillion miles a year, reaches us in 8 minutes of time. That's just amazing. And then think about our own physical human bodies. And think in particular of that small muscle about the size of a fist. It lies behind our fence of ribs, a little left of center called the heart. The heart is the body pump, and it's a medical marvel in and of itself. This little muscle pumps 5,000 gallons of blood every 24 hours. A person, it is said, who lives to be the age of 70 has a heart that weighs little more than a pound, and that heart has pumped 150 million gallons of blood in those 70 years' time. And the wonder of that is, it is so constructed that the heart can rest without ever stopping, due to the law of rhythm by which it operates. And so in a lifetime of 70 years, our heart will spend nearly 40 of those years resting. Now the question is, who is it that would be able to monitor the vastness of our world, the operation of our universe, and the function of our physical bodies? I mean, who would cook and control everything that is and yet still have time to think about us? There can only be one person that can do that, of course, and that is our great sovereign God. Now, in this text this evening, the psalmist is going to reflect and examine this wonderful attribute of God's sovereignty, and he does it by looking at past, prophetic, and present events. And these prove to us that our God is still on his throne. He is still in control. He is still sovereign. And so I want us to examine this passage this evening. And here the psalmist begins by explaining God's sovereignty and how it's declared by past events. I want you to look in your Bible there at verse number 6 and notice what he says. He says, "The heathen raged, the kingdoms were moved, he uttered his voice, the earth melted." Right here he's referring to something that happened in the past. He's declaring the sovereignty of God in past events. And what we see here is how he's reflecting, first of all, upon a tragic destruction. He's talking about how the heathen were raging, how the kingdoms were moved, and so God would utter his voice and the earth would melt. And right there he's talking about how God would have his hand in destroying the heathen nations. Jump up to verse 8 and notice what the psalmist says there. He says, "Come, behold the works of the Lord, what desolations he has made in the earth." So again, he's talking here about something that was tragically destroyed. And we need to keep in mind, once again, what the psalmist was referring to specifically. And we have seen in our study of this psalm, this was written based upon the army of the Assyrians and how they invaded Jerusalem. The city of God was completely surrounded. It was suppressed. They were under enemy attack. They were facing incredible opposition. And Sennacherib, the Assyrian king, had written Hezekiah a letter. He was telling him not to be tricked into believing that God would deliver them from his hand. He hadn't done it for these other nations. How did Hezekiah think he would do it for them? So Hezekiah then went and he took that letter and he spread it out before the Lord and he sought God's intervention. And as a result, the Lord answered the king's prayer. God stepped in and with only one angel killed 185,000 Assyrian soldiers, and he destroyed their entire army in one night. Now, Hezekiah got up the next morning. He looked down from the battlements of Jerusalem, and we're told that they were all dead corpses. Can you imagine that? And so the psalmist is thinking of that particular event, okay, as he reflects upon this tragic destruction that had just taken place in the past. You know, I think one of the most tragic events that ever occurred in our history was the sinking of the Titanic. That was a ship that was massive in its workmanship, and at the time it was the longest vessel that had ever been built. It covered over four city blocks in its length. It accommodated a crew of 860 people and a passenger capacity of 3,500. Her 50,000 horsepower engines that produced the 24 knots per hour speed were secured in 16 watertight compartments. Each was protected by these massive steel bulkheads. And so at the time of her launch, the Titanic was the world's largest man-made movable object. Now, on May 31st, 1911, an employee of the White Star Company, thinking of this awesome piece of work, said this: not even God himself could sink the Titanic. Well, by the way, folks, that is not a very good statement to be made at all. And on April 14, 1912, at 11:40 in the evening, the ship, making her maiden voyage across the Atlantic, struck an iceberg, and by 2:20 in the morning, nearly 3 hours later, the ship began its descent to the ocean floor. Tragically, 1,522 humans perished in the icy waters of the North Atlantic that evening. But what was so amazing about that devastation is that the rescue ship that heard the distress signal, called the Carpathia, was many, many miles away. It took that ship the entire night to reach the disaster location. But an investigation revealed that there was another ship, the California, that was only 12 miles away. And it could have been on the scene, they say, in less than 1 hour. It very well could have saved most of the people that were on board the Titanic. However, 5 minutes before that SOS signal went out, the radio operator on the California, having grown drowsy, took off his earphones and went to sleep. Now, I've said all that to say this: human beings fail. All right? The best well-laid plans of men and mice doesn't always materialize. You know, why? Because men are not always in control. But God never fails. God is always in control. And here in Psalm 46, the writer is reviewing a night when God stepped on the scene and he turned back the enemy that came up against his people. When all was said and done, all that was left was a heap of ashes and a pile of bodies. And so that's what's happening here to start out. The psalmist is reflecting upon a tragic destruction. And then we see next here how he reflects upon a triumphant deliverance. Again, in verse 6, he tells us that God uttered his voice. The earth melted. And in verse 8, he invites us to come, behold the works of the Lord. And so the writer is thinking of how God did what no one else could do on this occasion in delivering his people. This had happened many times to other nations where the mighty Assyrian army had come in and had attacked and defeated these people and these other nations. And so here are these people now, completely surrounded by the Assyrian enemy. And even though Hezekiah was able to create that river we talked about last time, he thought there might not be any way of escape. He looked to his confidants, his closest advisors, and yet they couldn't do anything to remedy this situation. But when he turned to God, he saw that here's the Lord, the only one that could help him. And he watched as God not only brought about this tragic destruction I mentioned a moment ago, but he brought about a triumphant deliverance as well. God is a great deliverer. I read one time about a Chinese village years ago. A fire erupted, and an old Christian woman went up to the roof on her little home, and she cried out so that all the neighbors could hear, "Jesus, please save my house." As the people heard her, they began to laugh at her and ridicule her. They said, "You old fool, get off that roof. Jesus can't save your house, like much less any of these other homes." Well, the night went on, and the fire raged. But when the morning came, amidst the charred ruins and desolation, there was only one house left standing, and it was that little old Chinese woman. Now, folks, I don't know about you tonight, but I can look back at my life and I can see that mighty sovereign hand of God. I can remember back when I was trapped in the mire of sin. I was in so deep that nothing else could help me or pull me out. But then the Lord Jesus, in his mercy and grace, reached further down than I could reach up. And thank God he saved me and brought me up out of that miry clay of sin. He delivered me. And so, lest you think that your salvation is mere coincidence. Let me tell you something tonight. It is the sovereign work of a mighty God in delivering you. And so the psalmist is doing that here. He's looking back and he's recalling what God had done in the past. He's reflecting on that tragic destruction of that Assyrian army, and he's looking at that triumphant deliverance of God's people. And then as we move on, we see next here how God's sovereignty is also determined for prophetic events. The writer shifts his focus now. He goes from God's sovereignty from the past events to his sovereignty in prophetic events. There appears to be somewhat of an expectation and a determination of God's sovereignty in coming days. We see that here as the psalmist explains that there's a look to a future battle. Look now, if you will, in your Bible to verse 9. It says here of God, He makes wars to cease unto the end of the earth. He breaketh the bow and cutteth the spear in sunder. He burneth the chariot in the fire. All right, so while the writer is thinking about what God has already done, he's now thinking about what God is going to do. He's looking to this future battle. And specifically, I believe the psalmist is looking to that day when the Lord Jesus comes back to this earth, okay, to destroy the armies of the world, known as the Battle of Armageddon. Now, the prophet Isaiah spoke of that day in Isaiah 2 and verse 4, when he said, He shall beat their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks. Isaiah spoke of this battle in the 34th chapter of his prophecy when he said, The indignation of the Lord is upon all nations, and His fury upon all their armies. He has utterly destroyed them. He has delivered them to the slaughter. Again, he's referring to that future battle in the Valley of Megiddo at the end of the tribulation period. This will occur at Christ's second coming as he begins to set up his millennial kingdom. It'll be a devastating and an awful battle. It's one that John described in great detail in Revelation chapter 16. I want you to think about this. This battle of Armageddon, it's going to stretch from Megiddo on the north to Edom on the south, a distance of 200 miles. It'll reach from the Mediterranean Sea to Moab, a distance of 100 miles. And into this area, multiplied millions of men, estimated an approximate 400 million men will gather here for the final holocaust of humanity. When all is said and done, the scripture says the blood is going to flow for 200 miles long and up to the horse's bridle. Without question, this is going to be the fiercest and most fatal battle ever fought in the history of mankind. It is going to happen. It is slated for the future. Now, that's a prediction that God made, and it's going to take place. I think of some of the world's worst predictions that have been made down through history. For example, King George II in 1773 said that the American colonies had little stomach for a revolution. Well, he learned differently. In 1939, the New York Times said that people would never have time to watch television that had been newly invented. He was wrong. In the 19th century, an English astronomer professor said that air travel at high speeds would be impossible because passengers would suffocate at those high speeds. Well, he was wrong as well. But the fact remains that this battle referred to by the psalmist is something that will take place. It is going to happen someday. How do we know that? Because of the sovereign hand of God. And because he has declared that in his word. Now, in Zechariah 14 and verse 2, God said this. He proclaims this. He said, I will gather all nations against Jerusalem to battle, and the city will be taken. So you see right there, we can see that it's God who's going to be directing everything, and he's the one that's going to be organizing this event. And let me just say, too, that you don't want to be here on this earth when this battle begins. Because when God's wrath is being poured out, it'll be utter devastation. It will be annihilation. And so the writer is speaking of this prophetic event. There's this look to this future battle. But then notice there is also a look to a future blessing. Look again at verse 9. He mentions that God will make wars to cease. Now, when is that going to happen? Well, that's going to happen, folks, during the millennium. Okay? And not until then. Now, the blessing of this event is twofold. One, we will not be here. during the tribulation period, and two, when it's over, we're going to come back with the Lord Jesus, and we're going to reign with him for 1,000 glorious years. That's a blessing. And when you examine the book of Revelation, you're going to find that from Revelation chapter 6 all the way out to chapter 19 and verse 6, the church is never mentioned. You won't find the word church there at all, or even a picture of the church. Why? Because, thank God, all the church saints will be gone from the earth by way of the rapture, and we're going to be enjoying the splendor of heaven, and we're going to miss out on the horrors of the tribulation period. I don't agree with all these people that say that we're going to be here through part of it, half of it, almost all of it. I don't believe any of that. I believe that we're going to be gone, thank God. And so the fact of the matter is, in Revelation 19 and verse 11, we see this rider on the white horse. He is called Faithful and True. He's going to come down to this earth, followed by the armies of heaven or the saints of God. Who is this? This is Jesus. And it says he has on his vesture a name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And when this battle is over, we are going to reign with the Lord Jesus for all that 1,000 years. And we're going to enjoy his rule and experience his reign. This is going to be an amazing future blessing. And so we see God's sovereignty in this psalm, this passage in this Psalm 46, declared by past events. It's determined for prophetic events. But now there's something else here I want you to notice in closing. And that is this: God's sovereignty is also demonstrated in present events. Okay? So while we can rejoice in what God has done in the past, we can rejoice in what he's going to do in the future, we can be thankful that we can also rejoice in what he's doing right now in our present day. So the writer now seeks to focus upon that aspect. And we see here that God is present, first of all, in our daily situation. Look at this phrase the psalmist uses in verse number 7. Look at verse 7. He says, "The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge." We see this first phrase again in verse 11. "The Lord of hosts is with us." Okay, so these verses show us that God is there. He's present in our daily lives. Once again, we have to keep in mind that background to this psalm. You've got a people, we got a king who are under the enemy attack for these Assyrians, and they're completely surrounded. There's no escape on the inside. Their beloved city is besieged. They're looking at this thing in desperation, thinking, man, there's nothing else we can do here. But in the midst of it all, the psalmist is remembering who is really in charge. He says it here, "The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge." All right, so while this is a reference to Hezekiah's present situation here, it is also applicable to our daily situation, whatever it may be. Okay, so the writer is seeking here to encourage our hearts and to remind us that, thank God, he is always present with us in our daily situation. And that means from the day we're born to the day we die, God's with us. Now, I shared this, I think, in the past that in Westminster Abbey at the grave of John Wesley, the founder of the Methodists, there are three sayings inscribed on his gravestone. One of them is, "I look on the world as my parish." Another one was, "God buries his workmen, but continues his work." And the final one is what Wesley said as he laid on his deathbed. He uttered it one time, and then, once again, raising his arm in triumph, he repeated it again. Here it was: "The best of all is God is with us." Now, there may be someone listening to this message tonight. You may be facing a great and burdensome situation. Maybe you're going through the middle of a fiery trial. It has left you not knowing what to do or what else to say or where to turn. If that's the case, I would encourage you to take this wonderful passage here, lodge it upon the wall of your heart, regardless of what you're facing, and zero in on this phrase here: "The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge." God is so good to us. Thank him. Thank God he's present in our daily situation, no matter what we're facing. And then not only is he present there, but notice this: he's present also in our daily struggle. Look again, if you will, at verse 9. The psalmist, while he's alluding to this prophetic event, he's also alluding to a present event. He's talking about an everyday event that we're all faced with, and that is the spiritual battle between the flesh, the devil, and the spirit. He's talking about that here. He breaks the bow. He cuts the spear in sunder. He burns the chariot in the fire. Now, in Ephesians chapter 6, it speaks of this spiritual battle that we as Christians are engaged in. Okay, and Paul wrote there in verse 12, "For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places." Now, I don't know about you tonight, but the thing that amazes me and thrills my heart is that God doesn't have to be there, but He is. He doesn't have to help us, but He does. He doesn't have to give us victory, but He will. I am so thankful tonight that God is not only present in our daily situations, but He's present in our daily struggles. In that passage in Ephesians 6, we are told in verse 10 to be strong in the Lord and in the power of His might. God says there, "Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil." We don't have to fight this daily spiritual battle alone. We have God with us. God gives us His power and His grace and His armor to win this victory over the devil and his demons. You know, I would hate to think what I could do without the Lord. But the blessed news is I don't ever have to be without the Lord. Okay, you don't either if you're saved. He is always there with us. He's in us. We who are saved, His sovereignty is demonstrated to us in our present events. I was reading one time about a story of two young boys, and they were up on this hilltop, and one of the boys was up in a tree stealing apples. The other boy, his friend, was standing guard, you know, just like you would have any crime scene of some burglars. There's always a lookout guy. And the other boy was watching to make sure that no one was observing their activity and what was going on at this apple tree. This went on for quite a little while, and they were continuing to retrieve as many apples as they could. However, the problem was they were completely unaware of the fact that several miles away there was a man in a window who was the owner of that land and that apple tree. He had seen their every move with a high-powered telescope. Those boys didn't realize it, but they were in for some serious trouble. Now, when you think of that story, you're reminded there's someone far greater and far more powerful than a telescope. He's watching everything that's going on. He sees everything that we do. He hears everything that we say. He's the God of heaven, who's the sovereign God in control of everything. And folks, may I remind you tonight that God is still at the control panel? I mean, God is pushing all the buttons, the right buttons, and thank the Lord He is still on His throne. He will always be on His throne. The old saying goes like this, where man rules, God overrules. I mean, the politicians in Washington, D.C. can say what they want to say, but our faith doesn't rest on Capitol Hill. Our faith rests in a God who rules the hill, and He can do whatever He sees fit to do. The psalmist has spoken in his passage tonight on the sovereignty of God in a wonderful way. He's revealed to us that God's sovereignty is declared by past events. It is determined for prophetic events. And His sovereignty is demonstrated in present events. Tonight we can be thankful and praise the Lord for the fact that He's still on His throne. And He is still not only our mighty God of security and stability and safety, but He's still our mighty God of sovereignty. And so may God help us tonight to know that He is in control of our lives. He's aware of everything that's happening and everything that's going on in our life. And may we, by His grace, continue to look to Him, to trust Him, and to give Him glory in all that we say and all that we do. Let's bow our heads and our hearts together for prayer. We thank You, Father, tonight for this great reminder that You are in complete and total control, not only of all of life's events, but of our own individual lives. And I pray, my God, that we'll always keep our focus on this truth. And that, God, we can look to You, we can trust You. And, Lord, we can look ahead to a future with hope and blessing and anticipation of what You're going to do. But Lord, meanwhile, we pray that we'll continue to look to you in the present day to help us in our daily situations and in our daily struggles. And Lord, I pray that we'll get the victory through your strength, through your might, that you might be exalted and glorified. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, I'm thankful you tuned in tonight. I trust that this passage here in Psalm 46, talking about God's sovereignty, has been a help to you, a reminder to you of how God is in total control. We have nothing to fear. All we need to do is trust him. All right? Trust you'll have a great week as we do that, as we rely upon the Lord, as we depend upon him for his might this week. God bless you. We are dismissed.